Hello all, happy Vijayadashami to everybody. Today we'll be talking about febrile neutropenia. This is a topic that's important not just for theory but from MCQ point of view, both your PG as well as super speciality, especially many questions have been asked. So I've tried to cover base with almost everything. So if you listen to this lecture, hopefully we'll be able to answer everything that is asked. So febrile neutropenia. What is the definition of a febrile neutropenia? So you have two parts in the name, isn't it? So you have febrile, you have neutropenia. So what is neutropenia? Neutropenia is absolute neutrophil count less than 500 per microliters, not the total cells. It means the neutrophils, or if the ANC is not at 500 but it is falling consistently and it is expected to reach 500 microliter in the next 48 hours, then that is neutropenia. And febrile part, how do you define that? Oral temperature of more than 38.3 degrees Celsius at least one time, or more than 38 degrees Celsius or 100.4 degree Fahrenheit two times in 12 hours. Then you consider it as a febrile neutropenia in a child with a background of a chemotherapy or a hematopoietic stem cell transplant. The risk of infection basically depends on the depth of neutropenia and the duration of neutropenia. It makes sense, right? Absolute neutrophil count of less than 100 will have more risk compared to that of a child who has less than 500. This will be more than to that of a child who has 1000, isn't it so? So on and so forth. And duration, as the duration increases, the risk of the child acquiring an infection also increases. So why this extra risk in a chemotherapy child who is having neutropenia? Because they usually have some sort of central venous catheter inserted. Compared to your portacath or to instill chemotherapy in, your central venous catheters have increased risk of having an infection. Functional neutropenia, I am not talking about the numbers, I am talking about the function, the phagocytosis, chemotaxis part, which will be affected secondary to chemotherapy. Next is mucositis. Especially in a patient who is receiving cytarabin therapy, they are more prone to have mucosal disruptions or discontinuation, which provides an opening for organisms to enter. Altered humoral or cellular immunity. Malnutrition in a child with chemotherapy, prolonged exposure to antibiotics as prophylaxis, or they might have received treatment also. Frequent hospitalization. So all of these increases the chances of a child acquiring an infection in the background of a febrile neutropenia, in the background of a child who is on chemotherapy agent for a malignancy. The clinical features may not be as florid as in a previously well child. Usually the symptoms and signs are subtle. You need to have a high index of suspicion to detect an infection, and you need to do a thorough head-to-toe examination including perineum, including IV cath site, to find out the site of infection. Nearly 75% of children with febrile neutropenia have a site of infection. If you look for it, you will find it. If you don't, then I don't know what to say, who's going to be at last. Obviously, it's the patient, right? So what investigations are you going to do when you suspect? Blood culture sensitivity is the first and foremost investigation. It's not just enough you take from a peripheral vein like usual. You need to take from central venous catheter, from every port of central venous catheter. Then depending upon what symptoms the child is exhibiting, your mode of investigations will vary. Say the child is having upper respiratory symptoms, then you will send for nasal aspirate looking for viral infection. You can do a sinus film if the child is having prolonged rhinorrhea. Say the same child is having a lower respiratory tract symptoms, then you will look at chest x-ray and CT. Chest x-ray, please note that all the time there may not be an infiltrate, especially if the child is having severe neutropenia. So absence of infiltrate in chest x-ray does not mean the child does not have an infection, especially if the child is symptomatic. Diarrhea wise, stool for virus you can look for, especially rotavirus, norovirus. Clostridium difficile toxin you will be able to look for. Urinary symptoms, that is a given. You will do a urine routine and a culture examination. abdominal pain, you look for tiflitus specifically with an abdominal CT. Suppose a child is not responding to the empirical antibiotics that you put for more than 96 hours, then you should consider fungal infection, and you will look for especially chest fungal infections with a chest CT, and you will look for fungal biomarkers like galactomannan and beta D glucan. What are the pathogens that you can expect? Most common is gram positive. Okay, it is not gram negative, it is gram positive infection. Of course, gram negative also occurs, but gram positive still remains the most common. Among gram negative, Enterobacteriaceae, your Pseudomonas, Klebsiella, all of those are important. So when you give treatment, when you suspect a child to have a gram negative infection or deteriorating, then you need to add gram negative coverage. If the child is having central venous catheter associated infection, a coagulase negative staph, CONS is coagulase negative Staphylococcus aureus, can be considered. But it's an indolent infection, and you know deferring treatment for 24 hours will not result in a drastic deterioration in the patient. A child who's having mucositis, a child who's on a fluoroquinolone prophylaxis, a child who is having acute myelogenous leukemia, they are all prone for Streptococcus viridans, and it can present as a toxic shock syndrome. So it is very important to recognize these risk factors. A child with prolonged neutropenia, not responding to antibiotic therapy, continuing to be symptomatic, then consider fungal infections, Candida and Aspergillus being the most common. So now you have investigated, or at least you have sent for investigation, what are you going to start the child on? So you will start on empirical therapy, cefepime and piptaz, okay, as monotherapy. Whether you need to add on something else to the cefepime or piptaz depends on the risk factors the child is having. Suppose you are suspecting a multi-drug resistant organism and the child is very unstable, in the sense septic shock like picture, hemodynamically unstable like picture, then you will add on an aminoglycoside or an aztreonam to cover gram-negative organism. So when do you suspect, or when do you think of adding vancomycin? Again, if the child is having hypotension or septic shock, catheter related infections, MRSA colonization, methicillin resistant Staphylococcus aureus colonization, if the patient is at risk of viridans infection, like we already discussed, a mucositis, AML or a fluoroquinolone prophylaxis, then you add vancomycin to the empiric line of therapy, which is cefepime or piptaz. Nelson says carbapenem should never be used as monotherapy. It is basically to prevent carbapenemase production in Enterobacteriaceae, because we are seeing more and more resistant organisms, isn't it so? But having said that, meropenem is used as first line therapy in many centers. Ceftazidime is not preferred as monotherapy if gram positive organism is suspected or resistant gram negative organism is suspected. Here one point I would like to tell is, if you see the flow chart in Nelson, it includes ceftazidime in the box, but it is not preferred if gram positive or resistant gram negative organisms are suspected in the patient. Please note this point. So is it only IV therapy that can be given? Can we not give oral therapy? You can give oral outpatient therapy provided a few criteria are satisfied. But in our Indian setting, it is always preferred to admit patient under observation intravenous therapy to make sure they complete the course of treatment under monitoring. So what are the criteria? The patient is able to take and absorb the oral antibiotic. There is a caregiver who will be able to understand your instructions and give the child these antibiotics. They are able to reach you in case of any emergencies over phone and physically to the hospital within 1 hour, meaning they are staying very close by to the hospital. They need to come for daily follow-up. The parent and the child agrees for an outpatient oral therapy, and the patient is not on fluoroquinolone prophylaxis. Why not on fluoroquinolone prophylaxis? This increases the risk of Streptococcus viridans, as we discussed. Okay, so if all these criteria are satisfied, then you consider giving outpatient oral therapy. You can give it with ciprofloxacin or ciprofloxacin plus amoxicillin clavulanic acid combination. So you started the child on IV, can you switch over to oral? Yes, again, if these criteria are satisfied, then you can do that. If the child has been afebrile for more than 24 hours, stable, clinically well, negative blood cultures, ANC is increasing and bone marrow recovery is indicated by increasing platelet counts, and more than 48 hours of intravenous therapy has been given, then switch from IV to oral therapy. You can give cefixime, cefpodoxime, levofloxacin, or your oral of ciprofloxacin with amoxicillin clavulanic acid. Okay, so with all this said, so how do you decide how long to give and when to add, when to subtract, all of those things? So this is an algorithm that you can follow. The decision of duration depends on first whether the child is stable or unstable, isn't it so? So whether the child, if the child is unstable, then you would want to continue, correct? Common sense. So if child is clinically worsening, look why the child is worsening. Is there a new infection or the previous infection is worsening because you have not treated the child properly? If the child is on oral antibiotics, admit the child for IV antibiotics. Investigations you can resend again if it was not sent, or you want to do it again to look for new onset infections. Treatment should be reviewed depending on the what the child is receiving. Suppose you think the choice of antibiotics is not appropriate, or the dose is underdosed, the route is not appropriate, then change it. If the child is not on vancomycin, consider adding vancomycin. If the child is on just empirical monotherapy and not meropenem, consider switching over to meropenem. Basically, you are trying to do a broad spectrum coverage. Aminoglycoside or aztreonam if you are suspecting gram negative, and antifungal should be considered. Suppose this child is clinically stable, okay? If the child has improved, then 7 to 14 days of antibiotics can be given depending upon what infection you isolate, meaning improved with a documented infection. We can put it like that, okay? So improved with a documented infection, 7 to 14 days of antibiotics depending upon the infection that you isolate with ANC more than 500. Suppose you were not able to isolate the organism, then you are in a sort of dilemma, isn't it so? The patient is worsening, then you go and follow the worsening protocol. Suppose the patient is stable, not worsening, but not having fever also, okay? So then you continue this empiric treatment till absolute neutrophil count rises to above 500 and discontinue the add-on, meaning after the empirical therapy you might have added on a vancomycin or an aminoglycoside, so you can discontinue that after 48 hours. Okay, suppose this child is stable but the child had a fever of less than 96 hours duration. Okay, so in this case you will do the same as afebrile child. You will continue empiric treatment till ANC is more than 500 and discontinue the add-on drugs, and you will watch for bone marrow recovery. If bone marrow is suggesting that the patient is improving very fast and is going to be out of the woods, then that's fine. If recovery does not seem imminent, then you need to think of antifungal agent. So antifungal agent, if you want to put everything together, the patient is having a recurrent infection, a persistent infection, persistent fever of more than 96 hours, persistent fever of more than 96 hours, bone marrow is not recovering despite empiric therapy, then you should consider adding antifungal. Liposomal amphotericin and caspofungin both have been shown to be equally effective. How long to give an antibiotic till blood culture is negative for 48 hours? If the patient is afebrile for more than 24 hours and absolute neutrophil count is more than 500 and increasing, then in that case you can stop your antibiotics. I think we have covered all the important points for your febrile neutropenia. So this is sort of a vast topic. I am not sure if I have run off too fast. So if there are any points that I missed, I will definitely let you know. If I made any mistakes, I will definitely let you know, or you can point out. We can update in the description box. Thank you guys for listening to me patiently. Happy Vijayadashami. Hope at least this brings victory to us as humans and doctors, and hope to have a better year at least next year. Thank you all. Share this with your friends, colleagues, juniors, seniors, or people who are interested in academics basically, so we can all learn pediatrics together. Bye bye and thank you.